Good day to you from ChemHelp ASAP. Let's explore carbocation rearrangements. We've seen hydride shifts, but we have another option. On the screen, we have an alcohol reacting with HCl. The alcohol is protonated to form water on the side of our molecule. With a little heat, the water might leave to form a carbocation. This is a secondary carbocation. As a secondary carbocation, we need to look for a possible way to get a tertiary carbocation. If we look for a viable beta hydrogen, we don't have one. We do have beta hydrogens over on this methyl, but if one of them shifts, we'll get a primary carbocation. It looks like we're stuck. Well, maybe not. As it turns out, carbon groups can also shift. Looking at our carbocation, if we could move one of these methyl groups from the neighboring carbon to the carbocation, then we would get a tertiary carbocation. It's exactly what happens. Just as a hydrogen can shift with its electrons, alkyl groups can also shift with their electrons. That's the mechanism arrow. Let's draw the product. Just like with hydride shifts, alkyl shifts occur from the an adjacent atom. So you're not going to move a methyl group from all the way on the other side of a molecule, four carbons away. Neighbors only. Once we get our new carbocation, it's now tertiary, the chloride can attack to give our SN1 product. Note that the SN1 product from the secondary carbocation will not be observed. Alkyl shifts are normally less common than hydride shifts. Alkyl shifts, however, are fairly common with strained rings, especially cyclobutanes. Here's another alcohol in the bottom left. Let's treat it with HCl. I'll skip some stuff. So after protonation and loss of our leaving group, we get a tertiary carbocation. Now, since it's tertiary, you might think we're done, but we're not. Next door is a strained cyclobutane ring. We'll actually have one of the ring carbons shift over to the carbocation carbon. These types of rearrangements are pretty messy, so let's number some carbons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Those are our really important atoms. What we're going to do is we're going to migrate this bond over to carbon 5. And so we're going to create a 5-membered ring. We're going to expand our ring and release that ring strain. So let's renumber again. That's 5. We'll make that 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's get our groups in place. Carbon 5 still has 2 methyl groups on it. That's fine. Carbon 1 is still just a CH2. Carbon 2 is a CH2, carbon 3 is a CH2, and on carbon 4 lost the bond that I'm making bold. So it still has a methyl group, but it lost the bond. That's where the carbocation now resides. So what have we accomplished? We went from a tertiary carbocation to a tertiary carbocation. This doesn't look all that favorable, but the fact is we relieved a large amount of ring strain. This rearrangement is very favorable energetically. Now that we have a more stable structure, the chloride can attack our carbocation carbon, and we will get our final product, which now have a 5-membered ring instead of a 4-membered ring. Now, note that we probably would not observe these simple SN1 product in this case. So carbocations can undergo more than just hydride shifts. Alkyl groups can also migrate. Alkyl shifts are driven by changes in ring sizes in order to release ring strain.